Mr. Deputy Chairman Sir, I crave the indulgence of the House and also your indulgence for stating certain obvious facts which are very well known but which we are often apt to forget. Sir, the Indian railway system, as the Honorable House knows, is the biggest in the whole of Asia and it is the fourth biggest in the world. It is also the biggest nationalized undertaking, and now here is such a big experiment made and such a large area covered. Sir, when we deal with the budget proposals, we have to bear in mind this far-reaching character and the historic role that the railway system is playing in this vast country. This budget as presented to us has to be viewed and considered from this larger angle. Though the budget has taken the usual form of an annual renewal, and though it indicates and projects a set pattern, it marks the culmination and the ending of a period of achievement and the budding and flowering of another period of achievement. Sir, we are in a better position today than before to assess and evaluate the results, and we can very well draw up a balance sheet of successes and failures, of achievements and setbacks if there are any, so that we may be able to draw up a plan of further development. During the last 5 years, efforts have been made by the Ministry of Railways to realize and fulfill the goals and targets laid down in the plan. To a considerable extent, I must admit, they have been able to achieve the goals and targets laid down. All these achievements and developments that have taken place are really commendable, and we would not shirk on our side to pay compliments to them because they deserve them. But when I look at the other side, when I consider the drawbacks and failures that we saw during these 5 years, I feel, sir, that the progress achieved and the developments that they have brought about are not commensurate with the needs and requirements of the growing and developing economy. The minister, in his speech, has not been able to assess the extent of demand of the country for additional transport capacity, and he has not been able to give us a picture of how this challenge will be met and met adequately to remove transport difficulties in the country. I would mention some facts and leave it to the judgment of honorable members as to whether some of the steps that the railway ministry has taken during this period of 5 years have been able to solve the transport difficulties In spite of the two plants and the additional capacity released as a result of development, the problem of congestion, which has also been referred to by other honorable members, is providing a great deterrent. It has proved a great deterrent in the past. It is proving a great deterrent and present, and perhaps it will prove a greater deterrent hereafter. This problem of congestion has been growing. Perhaps the planners were not able to visualize or anticipate the growing demand for transport in the country. Today, a very critical situation is created in spite of all developments. Goods are not being lifted from the ports. Complaints have been received about this. There is a lot of congestion at the various ports, and there has been considerable delay in moving goods from port areas. Complaints have also been heard that ores are not being moved from the mining areas, and the internal trade is put to a very severe strain. Reference was made to coal transport. Some of the reports which have appeared in today's papers are very disturbing. We are told that the crisis is very deep in the UP areas, and as a result of paucity of coal, many industries, perhaps even the railways there and the normal life in certain of those areas in UP have suffered considerably. It is amazing that the Minister of Steel, Mines and Fuel, while replying to questions this morning, was trying to shield the railway minister. He was saying that the difficulty in lifting coal was not entirely due to paucity of wagons. It was due to some other reasons. But he went on to say that the local authorities had to resort to road transport to move coal from those mines. If that is so, I do not know why. If the wagons had been made available in the past, and if they are made available today, there was necessity to move coal from the colliery by road transport. Road transport is costlier, and ultimately it is not economic. So we can very well say that there is a sort of friction or lack of coordination between the two wings. It has also been borne out clearly that transport of goods or ores has suffered because there has been wagon shortage. If there has been no shortage, at least there has been considerable delay in getting them.